peace to you from our Lord Jesus Christ, and welcome to this service of worship on the first Sunday of Advent. We're glad for those of you who are in the room, those of you who helped this morning at the Advent Festival to decorate the sanctuary and get us ready for the Advent and Christmas seasons here in Crafton Heights. I have a couple of announcements that I'd like to share with you as we begin our time together. The Building a Bigger Table discussion group will finish tomorrow. So if you're a part of that group, actually, if you haven't been and you want to read the whole book, we're going to finish the book tomorrow, and that will be by Zoom. The Texas mission trip we will be leading, Lord willing, and the Omicron variant don't rise. We will be leading a mission trip to Texas for adults in February. And there's information about that in your bulletins. The open door, all of the ornaments from the first batch of angel tree ornaments were taken. Bruce has replenished our tree. There is more need. And so they're all gone already. Oh, they're taken too. All right, well, you snooze, you lose, evidently, around Crafton Heights. I will say that Bruce has asked if you have taken an ornament, when you bring it back, put it in a gift bag instead of wrapping it. We have next week, we have the blood drive. Donors are urgently needed. I am convinced that I will never, ever be lost because the blood bank calls me every day to tell me how badly platelets and blood are needed. And so if you can give next week, shoot Michelle Kish an email or just walk in next week. A couple of announcements that are not in the bulletin. There are poinsettia forms right where Arlene just picked one up because that's the kind of leader Arlene is. If you would like to offer poinsettias for the sanctuary and help beautify Christmas Eve, take one of those. And today we're having the Sacrament of Communion. If you know of someone who's not able to be here but would like to receive the sacrament at home, please talk to me about that. We can make that happen. Advent starts today. This is the first Sunday of Advent. There are two things that we will invite you to do throughout Advent. Firstly, there's a slide for this, but I'm going to be leading a discussion. It's not a discussion group, because if you come and discuss, we'll probably kick you out. It's more of a reflection and thinking and sharing group. On this book called A Weary World, Reflections for a Blue Christmas. Kathy Escobar is a pastor who lost a son to suicide, and she writes this book thinking about how does one embrace the joy of Christmas while sitting in the knowledge of the pandemic and her own personal grief. If you'd like to be a part of that, it will be on four Tuesday nights, beginning a week from this coming Tuesday. In this book, you have opportunities for daily readings as well as some weekly practices. You can get this online. I can help you get it if you're not sure how to do that. But that will start on, I believe it's the 7th, is the first Tuesday night. The other practice to which I'd like to invite you is a series of emailed devotionals. Coalition for Christian Outreach, a campus ministry group with which I have been affiliated, is offering free email devotions to be sent to your mailbox. If you sign up today, you'll get one written by me tomorrow. I'm the leadoff hitter in this rotation, evidently. But a number of folks have come together to write these devotionals. They're scripture-based and 700 words long, thereabouts. So you can get the link for that in an email from me later today, the email that goes out with all the links. If you don't usually get one of those emails, let me know and I'll give you the link. It's easy. Having said all of that, that's a lot of announcements. I would like to invite the Klein family and whoever else is coming with the Klein family to come forward, and Bruce to light the Advent wreath and to call us to worship. Please stand.
Morning. We have endured the past few years and know that there is more to face before us. We don't know if we have enough strength to withstand what might be around the next corner. Who is with us? That is what we begin to wonder these days. And where we are, where are we, and where are we heading? Home. The prophet Jeremiah speaks of a branch that will grow up. Jesus spoke of the Son of Man that will descend. Both point to a high hope. A hope that calls us home, our true home, where we are welcome and loved and included, where there is justice, equality, and peace. This Advent season, we hope for home.
We light this candle as a sign of our hope, our strong hope, that there is a way to go home.
To the home of Christ.
And it starts with us. And it starts here. And it starts now.
It's time to go home.
Come, 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 come Please join me in the prayer of confession. Merciful God, always with us, always coming, we confess that we do not know how to prepare for your advent. We have forgotten how to hope in miracles. We have ignored the promise of your kingdom. We get distracted by all the busyness of this season. Forgive us, God. Let us continue. Grant us the simple wonder of the shepherds, the intelligent courage of the Magi, and the patient faith of Mary and Joseph, that we may journey with them to Bethlehem and find the good news of a child born for us. Now, in the quiet of our hearts, we ask you to make us ready for his coming. In front of us, behind us, to our right, to our left, look, God is there, in our past, beside us today, waiting in the future, look, God is there, in the shadows, in the light, look, God is there.
From the top of mountains to the bottom of the seas, in the morning, in the evening, in every moment, God is there.
In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
Even when we are overwhelmed or barely hanging on, we can give thanks, God. Amen.
Now we have the prayer of illumination. Emmanuel, as we wait for your return, help us see your glory and love through the reading and preaching of your word. We pray in your name. Amen. Amen. First reading comes out of the book of Jeremiah, chapter 33, verses 14 through 16. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will fulfill the promise I made to the house of Israel and the house of Judah. In those days and at that time, I will cause a righteous branch to spring up for David, and he shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. In those days, Judah will be saved and Jerusalem will live in safety. And this is the name by which it will be called, the Lord is our righteousness. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
And I invite the children to come be with me for a few minutes, please. You know, I was with my grandchildren over Thanksgiving, my granddaughters, and we read a book called The No Girls Allowed Club. And this is kind of our children's sermon for today, evidently. We have a bunch of young men here. It's good to see you guys. Now, is everybody in a place where you'll be able to see the screen? Because I have a picture that I want to show to you. Here comes somebody whose name was just read in the Bible verse, just like name is David. It's written in the verse, and Judah's here.
All right.
So, we have a picture here. I don't know, does anybody recognize where that is? That red house, what do you think, Levi or Micah? The red house on the left, that's where Samiah and Aviva and Piper live. That's what you thought. And the other house that's kind of white, you can hardly see any of it, that's my house. And that's the fence that's between our yards there. And there's these two pictures of this little tree there. Can you see? It's the same tree. Two different pictures. That's a mulberry tree. Now, when we bought our house a long time before any of you were born, there was a mulberry tree that grew right next to the fence. But as that mulberry tree got bigger and older, it started to lean. And it got bigger, it leaned some more. And then it leaned some more. And all of a sudden, I noticed that my fence was starting to bend. My fence was going to break. And so I said to the people who own the house, I said, I think we have to get rid of that tree or we have to get rid of the fence, one or the other. And they said, we'll chop it down. We don't like that mulberry tree anyway. And so they chopped the mulberry tree down. The next year, from where that mulberry tree was growing, what do you think happened? What's that? Well, it did, but that's not it. Right by where the tree was, there were some things that grew up, and what do? We cut them down. And the next year, further away, we cut them down. This tree that's here now is probably, you see where Judah is, probably about as far away from me to Judah as where the first tree was. Those roots just kept traveling underground and shooting up new springs. And finally, Piper's mom said, I'm just going to let this thing grow. And there you can see, it's bigger than I can put my hand around now. It's growing fast. It's big. The passage that Mr. Bruce read to us is a promise from God to people who were in a hard place. Their life wasn't going the way they wanted it to go. And he said, a new branch will come up from the old stump. That was his way of saying, you can't always see, but life will win. Hope will win. Goodness will win. It will always grow up. No matter how many times people try to knock it down, it will grow up. I look at that tree in my backyard, I remember God's promise. No matter how many times we tried to knock that tree down, it just kept coming. I want us to remember that in our life. We think about what it means for us to trust God even on days that seem so hard. Will you pray with me, please? Thank you, God, for the chance to be together today, for these young men and their parents, and for the ways that you are active in our lives, even in the times and places that we can't see it. We sure love you. Amen. Thanks, guys, for coming up. You can go back to the folks you were sitting with.
Our second reading is from the book of Luke, chapter 21, verses 25 through 36. There will be signs in the sun, the moon, and the stars, and on the earth distress among nations, confused by the roaring of the sea and the waves. People will faint from fear and foreboding of what is coming upon the world, for the powers of the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. Now, when these things begin to take place, Stand up and raise your heads, because your redemption is drawing near. Then he told them a parable. Look at the fig tree and all the trees. As soon as they sprout leaves, you can see for yourselves and know that summer is already near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you know that the kingdom of God is near. Truly I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. Be on guard so that your hearts are not weighed down by with dissipation and drunkenness and the worries of this life, and that day does not catch you unexpectedly like a trap. For it will come upon all who live on the face of the whole earth. Be alert at all times, praying that you may have the strength to escape all these things that will take place, and to stand before the Son of Man. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I suspect that some of you will remember my dear friend Anne, who died about 10 years ago after having attained the age of 102. Anne was an amazing woman in many ways. She was not your typical centenarian. Well into her 90s, it seems to me, she patrolled Noblestown Road with her dress shoes, her glossy lipstick, and her costume jewelry. She was a delight in so many ways. As I visited with Anne near the end of her life, I would often say, "Friend, how about some scripture today? Is there something that you would like for me to read to you?" And every single time, Anne would say, "Read me the part that is so scary." I have to admit, it took your pastor a while to figure out which scary part she was talking about. But I came to realize that she was referring to the passage from Luke and the little bit that precedes it, but that passage that you just heard a few minutes ago. And when Anne listened to those words, her eyes would close and her face would scrunch up, and she would say, "Ooh, Pastor, I've got goosebumps. It's terrible. I pray I won't be here to see it happen. But I'm so glad that he's coming back." She was so afraid of what she thought might be coming, and yet at the same time she marveled that Jesus loved her enough to include her in on this big thing that he was doing. Now, churches around the world often cite this text or its parallel passages in Mark or Matthew to mark the beginning of the Advent season. And often we key in on Jesus' command in verse 36, his exhortation to be alert, to stay awake, to pay attention. And so often on the first Sunday of Advent, churches sing songs like "Sleepers Awake" or "Wake Awake with Tidings Thrilling." We often talk about being clued in or attentive to everything around us so that we don't miss out on this great thing that God is doing. Be on guard, stay awake, be alert. I mean, that is great advice for people who anticipate that something amazingly good is going to happen. Or when there's so much life and activity blazing around you that you don't want to miss a single thing. But if you are in the midst of a season of pain or loss, well, that's the last thing that you want to hear. We're angry. We're sick and on edge. We're tired. We're sad. Moreover, we are tired of being sad and angry and sick or on edge. We don't want to wake up. We'd rather sleep in, thank you very much. We don't want to watch out. We'd rather check out. Give us another drink. Let us watch another episode. Let us escape this discomfort a little longer, please. We are not interested in being attentive to anything right now because everything hurts. And here comes Jesus proclaiming the advent of the kingdom of God. You heard him commanding us to watch, to wait, to stay awake. And you know what, Jesus? Some of us are not ready for that kind of holiday. Thanks just the same. Welcome to Advent, church. Some of you couldn't wait for it. Others of us are shocked that it's here already. But no matter how you personally feel, it begins today. So why do we do this? What's the point of Advent? So far as I can figure it, especially in this pandemic year, the call of Advent is not to rehearse a weary story about an unlikely marriage or a couple on the go or a grouchy innkeeper. And I must admit that I find myself surprised that I'm saying this, but because it seems like something I would trumpet to you, but the call of Advent is not necessarily to steel ourselves against the consumerism and the materialism and the excesses that the holidays will bring to us. I don't think that these weeks leading up to Christmas Eve are a time of fasting before we binge on too much food or eggnog or cheap plastic stuff. I believe that the primary call of Advent is to help us to remember and to live the truth that, as Anne herself knew, whoever we are, wherever we are, and whatever is happening, we live rooted in the promised truth that we are included in the presence of God in Jesus Christ. God is with us, he is called Emmanuel. And because God in Christ is with us, we need not fear that we will be overwhelmed. I'm struck that today's readings both use the metaphor of a tree, and I'd like to explore that a little bit as we consider the gift of Jesus' presence with us on the journey. The first reading from the book of Jeremiah, and for the sake of context, I want to let you know that Jeremiah's work is centered around the time when God's people prior to the work of Nehemiah, which we've been reading here in worship. Jeremiah was preaching to the people as the nation was being overrun, as the nation was falling, as the people are going into beginning the exile, of which Nehemiah trumpeted the end. Jeremiah is at the other end of that, and the promises that God has made to the people all seem hopelessly in the past, and the future seems nothing but bleak. And yet Jeremiah says that there will be a righteous branch that will sprout from David's line, and that's a fine and lovely thought, and it fills the reader with precious memories, memories of those times when the world was in order and when being a part of God's people apparently meant something to somebody. But the folks to whom Jeremiah is preaching are people who have to crane their necks backward in order to see those things. So far as they can tell, the tree of David has been chopped down, and the leadership of Israel is, to put it mildly, in disarray. There are foreign powers desecrating God's temple and presence. Things are definitely not the way they used to be, and they're not the way they're supposed to be. And yet, says the prophet, we're not dead yet either. A branch is emerging from the old rootstock, and a new season will come. Things will not always be the way they are right now. And Jeremiah wants to remind his hearers that life and love are present, even in difficult seasons. And in the passage from Luke, Jesus interrupts his violent imagery of disturbances in the celestial sphere and earthquakes and tidal waves to talk about, of all things, fig trees. The stark contrast is only deepened when we realize that the analogy of the fig tree can only work if we are willing to assume a cycle that includes times of dormancy, fruitlessness, and even apparent deadness. Speaking to those who are alarmed by what he said about the end of the world, Jesus points to the silent, slow growth of leaves that will harvest the energy of the sun and produce a flower that will receive pollination from the insects and birds in order to produce a delicious and sweet-smelling fruit. You see what Jesus is doing here. He's guiding his followers and you and me down a path. He begins with this notion of a theological construct. That is God in charge? Are God's promises valid? And then he leads us through this series of a sensational cataclysmic event, and he arrives at a reality that includes attentiveness to personal and corporate practices that will sustain us during the hard times. And you need to know that Jesus is speaking in the second person plural here. That is, when Jesus says you, he really means yins, the group, all of us. Guard your hearts, stick together, spend yourselves on those things that truly matter. When Luke was telling the story of Jesus' life, I can't think that it was accidental that he took this teaching, one that the scholars refer to as the Little Apocalypse, and he put it just before his narration of the Last Supper. And I think that in doing that, in structuring and editing his work this way, Luke meant to clearly communicate at least three things. First, whatever is going to happen, it will be better for the disciples and for the world that the disciples live in if they stick together. Secondly, that the followers of Jesus can count on his presence. It is, in fact, every bit as real and every bit as nourishing as their next meal. And lastly, no matter how fierce the winter may be or how bad the storms may get, their time for growth and for fruit is still ahead. So what do we do with all of this? How are we going to live into these truths here in Advent 2021? Are we able to hope that even in the midst of apparent chaos and pain, that God is on the move and that growth and life are realities and possibilities for us? I mentioned that the scholars of theology often refer to this passage as the Little Apocalypse. Apocalypse means disclosure or revelation, telling of something that's important. And for centuries, theologians have used the beginning of Advent to climb into the pulpit and to thunder about apocalypse and about eschatology, that is, the end of the world, the closing of human history, the second coming of Jesus. And they use big words to talk about big events that reveal the fact that what we have always seen and known and felt is in fact temporary, that something else is unfolding. And all of those things are true. But sermons that focus only on this next big thing require a lot of conjecture and what if, and they can feed fear and raise anxiety. We get goosebumps in church, yeah, but what else? And so for that reason, this week, I'd like to encourage you to take an honest and personal look at these words. This is an apocalyptic passage. It has to do with revealing some knowledge. So do that. This week, I want to invite you to begin your observance of Advent by speaking, by revealing the truth of your life to someone as honestly as you can. Don't fall into the trap of hiding your pain or loss behind some gift wrap or some bright lights. Don't be shamed into thinking that maybe you're not a real Christian if you can't get all happy clappy when December rolls around. Can this Advent be an opportunity for you to speak an apocalypse of yourself to someone whom you trust, someone who loves you? Let me ask you to sit with that person for an hour or so and reveal how it is to be you right now in this season. Where do you hurt? What do you question? How are you wondering right now? And if you do this, it will require an act of bravery on your part. Our culture wants us to paper over the pain and difficulty and loss. Our culture trains us to say things like, "Ah, you know, I'll be all right. I just need to get busy, and then I'll get back on track." Well, you know what? I'm not sure that you need to be any busier. I think that the call of God to us this Advent season is to own who and where we are right now, to name the losses that we have suffered and the pain that we have felt, and to speak to where our experiences have brought us so far. As we engage in this holy truth-telling and listening, we can then be free to watch and to wait with and for each other. And when that happens, the promise of God that as quietly as a stump sends out a new branch, as slowly and predictably as a tree comes to leaf when the sap begins to run in the spring, and as mysteriously as a baby conceived in the dark, moist places of our existence, in ways like that, God is in fact with us. God with us in the middle of this mess. Can you believe it? If that doesn't give you goosebumps, I don't know what will. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Number 140.
Once
Friends, we have the opportunity to share our congregational life, to give voice to our joys and concerns as we gather. There are a number of folks who need your prayers as we worship together. Peter Veldman is not here today. Peter wishes that he was here, but he's home with pneumonia and reports that he's feeling better than he was, but not good enough to be with us. And so we want to pray with and for Peter. Our friend Bob Walters has been hospitalized with COVID, and Bob is having a rough go of it right now. I would ask you to pray for Bob and for his daughter Jennifer, who's trying to help. Bob's suffering is compounded by the fact that he's having a hard time hearing. Bob's hearing is not that good, and the hospital is a loud and distracting place, and the folks who know him best can't get close to him because of the isolation. We pray also for Debbie Dolenz, who is recovering from COVID. Yesterday was a much better day for Debbie than the previous week had been. Josh Mell is also ill. Pray also for Marge Freeman, who is recovering from surgery and is still currently at a rehab facility, but we hope and pray, and your prayers this week might be that she is restored to the mobility that allows her to get back to her own apartment. That's what I have in front of me here. There may be things I've forgotten or that I didn't know. Is there anything that you would like to share? Hannah. Prayers for those in Peru who have experienced an earthquake, a pretty severe earthquake today. Thank you. Ray. Prayers for your sister who's dealing with the after effects of a stroke.
And now has COVID.
Oh my. Thank you for that. You know, I'm stepping around this plexiglass as if somehow I'll be able to hear you better. Forgive me for that. But prayers for Ray's sister. Anything else today? Bruce. Okay, prayers for Bruce's son Ben, who lost a dear friend in a drive-by shooting. Sarah. Okay, prayers for Sarah's folks who are dealing with COVID right now and for what that means for your whole extended family. Yeah, thank you. What are your parents' names?
Rich and Maureen?
Lorraine.
Fritz and Lorraine. I knew Lorraine.
I have a joy.
Yeah.
Tomorrow we get to go see the baby, so 20 weeks sonogram, super excited. Just with the anxiety I've had through this pregnancy after losing one, so that's a joy that will help, you know, wash that away.
Yeah, thank you for that, Megan. Anything else today? Let's keep praying. Lord, we give you thanks for your presence here, and we crave that we might be a living reminder of your presence to those for whom it seems distant. We pray for those who struggle with illness, particularly those who are in COVID and maybe in isolation. We ask that breath would come freely. We pray that you would free our friends from their enslavement to this disease, and that you would bring health and wholeness. At the same time, we pray for those who provide care and for those who are on the front lines of research and working to find ways to keep not just us and the people we love, but the world safer and healthier. We ask that you would give us endurance to continue to do those things which help to mitigate this virus, and that we might be neighbors who are positioning ourselves to care with and for the world. We pray for the world that hurts, particularly our friends in Peru, We ask that you would be with those who are brokenhearted, that you would hold fast to those whose lives are still shaking, and that you would bring to them the grace and peace that comes from knowing you. We ask, O Lord, that you would hear these prayers that I've said out loud and those of our hearts, that we might trust in you and walk closer in you. In the name of Christ we pray, and for his sake. Amen.
Now we have the invitation to the offering. We are the work of God's hands, the psalmist says, and God continues to shape us each day into a people of goodness and peace. That is why we bring gifts this morning to be part of the creating a more beautiful world through the ministry of this church and the witness of our lives each and every day. Let us gather our gifts together and present them as an offering to God. Those who are worshiping in the building this morning will note that there are offering plates at the rear of the sanctuary. You may feel free to leave a gift there now or on your way out of the room in a few moments. Those who are worshiping online will find instructions on the screen.
We come today bringing our gifts and dedicating them to your service. Bless these gifts and use them to serve the needs of the many who need to know your presence. We bring them with joy in our hearts and songs of hope and praise on our lips. Amen.
Friends, as we prepare to receive the Lord's Supper, I will let you know that we observe an open communion table, that those of you who love and claim Jesus Christ are welcome to attend the service of communion. You don't need to be a member of this church. You don't need to be a Presbyterian. You need to be a child of God to be served at God's table. The way we'll do communion today is after we have our hymn of preparation, the table will be uncovered. I'll invite the musicians to come forward first, then the folks on this side to come down this aisle, cross over, and return to your seats in the back. Then the folks in the middle will come out this aisle, up, and then come around. And then lastly, you folks over here can go to the back and come around and receive. If you're at home, please grab something that is close to you that would look cracker-ish and liquid-ish, and join us as we move into this service of communion. Who is invited to the Lord's table? All are invited, the young and the old, the rich and the poor, the lowest and the least, sinners and saints together in communion. Come and find your place here where there are no strangers or foreigners, only brothers and sisters in the sight of God. Why do we give thanks at this table? We give thanks because Jesus showed us the way. We give thanks because Jesus is the way. Jesus was a gift from God for the world. He was called Emmanuel, God with us. He came to save us from our sin. He lived a life of thankfulness and gave his life as a sacrifice for many. We give thanks that he is our Savior, Christ the Lord. Why do we eat and drink at this table? We eat because on the night before Jesus died, he ate with his friends. He gave them the bread, and he said, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." At the same meal, he took a cup of wine, and he said, "Drink this cup. This is the blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sin." What do we remember at this table? We remember Jesus' birth and his presence as God with us. We remember Jesus' life and his love. We remember Jesus' suffering and death on the cross. We remember the resurrection and the promise of life. We remember that we are waiting in hope to see Jesus again. Let us prepare our hearts and minds to receive the sacrament.
Friends, will you pray with me? We lift up our hearts to you, Lord. It is good and right and fitting that we should do so. We praise you and give you thanks this Advent season that you are a God who is on the move, that you are a God who is at work in the silent and dark places of our lives. We give you thanks that you have promised us in Jesus Christ to never leave us alone, to never leave us in a place of death, but to always bring us to life. We ask that as we move forward in this Advent season, that you would unveil yourself to us even more, that we might know and hold on to and believe that promise that we have received. We give you thanks for your Son, Jesus Christ, who moved among us and who taught us and who lived your truth with us. We give you thanks that he has loved those who were broken, and that even he was murdered by those he loved, and yet that he is still a friend of sinners. We ask that you would be with us as we watch and wait for the ever more full signs of his resurrection and life in our lives and in our world. And now we pray that you would send your Holy Spirit upon the breaking of the bread and the sharing of the cup, that the things that we may do might be your work, the things that we say might be your words, and the ways that we live might be as your people. We ask all these things with Christ, through Christ, who with you and the Holy Spirit reigns one God forever and ever, and who teaches us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The Lord Jesus, on the night of his arrest, took bread, and giving thanks to God, he broke it. And he said, This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup. And he said, This cup is the new covenant, which is poured out for you in my blood. As often as you drink this, remember me. Friends, these are the gifts of God for the people of God. I'll invite you to come forward. Matt will have the bread. I'll have the cup. And if you would prefer to have one of those prepackaged things that has not been touched by anybody, these are up here as well.
Let us pray. God of grace, thank you for this bread and wine, and for the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ. God of hope, fill us with your Spirit today, that we might have the wisdom to understand the mystery of this table, and the depth and height and breadth and length of your love for us. Through this meal, strengthen us to be followers of Jesus, in a community of peace in a broken world.
Now, beloved, go out into the world in peace and have courage. Hold on to that which is good and return to no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted and support the weak. Help the suffering and honor all people. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power and the presence of our Holy Spirit. And may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God the Father and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forever. And let the whole church say, Amen. Amen.